Salaam from the NewsClick studios in New Delhi. I'm Siddhanth Aney, and with me on the show, this is Playthings of Alien Forces. With me on the show, as always, is our sports editor, Leslie Xavier. Leslie, year-end special. Ending the year on a high, actually, for Indian sport, because some good news from the World Badminton Championships that happened over this weekend.
Yeah, not bad. Srikanth reaching the final, winning the silver, and again, for the men's, it's an unprecedented feat. Mm. We have so far only won bronze medals. And a great way to end the season as well, because Indian badminton, if you look at it from the, overall perspective, it was a good year. Mm. Olympic medal for Sindhu, as expected. Probably the colour should have been better, but again, it's a tight game over there, and she did well to be on the podium again, back-to-back Olympics. Yeah. And towards the end, we had seven players in the World Tour Finals, qualified for the World Tour Finals. Mm. Again, a big achievement when you look at qualifying itself, because you are talking about the top eight players in the world.
Yeah.
And top players or doubles pairs.
Mm. Mm.
And out of which, again, Sindhu and youngster Lakshya Sen, he reached the semi-finals, and he missed out on a medal, and Sindhu reached the final and a silver. So, good year. After that, World Championship happened, a busy year for them also. Mm. It was the end of the year, back-to-back global level tournaments as such.
Mm.
But again, I have a different view on that, and which we were also discussing earlier before.
Yeah, I was going to say, we have this WhatsApp group that is Leslie, myself, and our eternal skeptic, Mr. Vaibhav Raghunandan. And these guys had a quite interesting take on what happens post an Olympic cycle.
Yeah, so if you look at Srikanth's career trajectory, it's an interesting journey, because he is considered a world-level player. He is considered, when he reaches top 10, he was world number one previously. It was the end of 2018. And when we look at Srikanth, generally when we mention him, we think of him as a top 10 player, period, quality-wise.
Mm.
But just that Srikanth's run in the top rungs sort of happens. He misses the bus when it comes to Olympics.
Right.
It happens after the Olympics, usually. 2018, like I mentioned, when he became world number one, that's right in the middle of two Olympics. And now, look at it. The Olympics got over, and he's just showing signs that he can become the world number one again. But 3 years away from the Olympics. So, this is something that I've discussed about Sindhu as well, long back. This discussion, this thing in my mind, it has been playing in my mind for a while now.
Mm.
That the idea of which tournament or which competition to peak, this is very important in modern sport, because it's simply very difficult to sustain yourself at a high intensity through the season, day in, day out. And then also when the stakes are high, bring that game out. Classic example of, since we are talking about badminton, there are examples in tennis and all this sport. But in badminton, classic example was Lindan. The Olympics or World Championship, this man comes and wins everything and goes away.
Mm.
And then he fades. He's not there, but he's there too, because he's planning his next trajectory.
Right.
So this is something that Srikanth or Indian players seem to have missed, or the management for that matter, because you have to plan this very systematically.
Yeah.
Sindhu does that beautifully. Sindhu, we always address and describe Sindhu as a big tournament player.
Yeah.
What is a big tournament player? It is that planning that is required to step-by-step increment and ensure that you are there on the boil, in perfect zone when the big tournament is happening. And then ease off a little. Now, after the Olympics, Sindhu eased off. Sindhu's first two tournaments, she never reached the semifinals.
Mm.
She was building it. World Tours, she did better.
Mm.
And if you look at rest of the players also, they are on and off now after the Olympics. The Olympic medalists, for instance.
Mm.
And yesterday's Srikanth's finalist
opponent
was world number 22, Singaporean player. And on a given day, considering that Srikanth was ranked higher, he should have beaten him. But for some reason, after taking an initial lead in the match, he just faded as well. So it was a game of, in that sense, elite level lesser mortals.
Mm.
And out of which one of the players had to lose, and it happened to be Srikanth. Yeah, I would say missed a great opportunity to add a world title into his resume.
Yeah.
But I would also hope that there is some more system in place for planning these players' journey,
yeah.
especially someone like Lakshya Sen.
Mm.
He won bronze in the World Championship, which is, again, considering his age, he is just 19.
Mm.
So it's a big achievement. Yeah, again, his peak form has started after the Olympics. He never qualified.
Mm.
And so I'm just hoping that from here, because next year is a big tournament year also for India with Asian Games,
Asian
Commonwealth
Games.
And
yeah.
Of course, badminton, the tour continues on parallelly.
Yeah.
A planning and system is in place so that he doesn't burn out or get injured or whatever, which is something that happened to Srikanth. He got injured playing the Nationals in 2019.
Yeah. Yeah.
Why should a world number one play Nationals unless if there is some
something
plan to it?
Yeah. So I think one of the things, and again, I guess this is important because this is, after all, Playthings, is that the challenge for these players, particularly on tour, is to participate perhaps in as many events as possible so as to maximize the amount of prize money that they can potentially earn, especially with like sort of bigger money tournaments like the year-enders and all of that. That's one thing. And then also in terms of the frequency of tournaments they play, because of sponsor commitments and other things like that, they, I think, need to be a little bit more on the court versus players, let's say, like the Chinese gang that probably gets a lot more state support.
Mm-hmm.
Because here, and I may be wrong on this, but I don't think so, but even under the TOPS scheme, which is the central government scheme for elite level athletes who are supposed to have a chance of winning an Olympic medal, even there, they are better off the more they play.
Mm-hmm.
So the more time they are spending on tour, the more sort of support they are getting from the state to go and compete and play, and then some allowances and such. So perhaps these are some of the pulls that come into play when it comes to deciding. And Sindhu, because you mentioned Sindhu and how good she is at planning, it's also because a large chunk of Sindhu's earnings now, because she has made herself into a market-friendly, marketable figure, a lot of her income comes from endorsements.
Mm-hmm.
So she doesn't necessarily have to bank on prize money or even state sponsorship in order to sort of make ends meet, as it were, or have a decent, living, earn a decent living wage.
It's again, it's one more factor is there to add to what you said.
Mm.
So it's not just about the prize money here. It's also about ranking. The more you play, you get ranked, you get a better draw.
Yeah.
You won't end up playing the world number one in the first
early
round.
Stages. Yeah.
So it's that matters too. So, and then also the mandate from BWF, World Federation, that you should have so many numbers of tournaments under your belt.
Yeah.
So there have been discussions in badminton about player burnout and all that.
Mm.
And the key here is intensity.
Mm.
And physical form and game form, and it can be varied. It can be planned by simple science, which is very prevalent now in sports and fitness management and all that, which is periodization.
Mm.
So you start the year off in a systematic manner, but you are not in your peak, and you decide where you want that peak, and you periodize your training, your competition, your exposure. So, yeah, you play, you reach the semifinals of various tour events, but then when the moment comes, you are winning.
Mm.
And this is key for other sport as well. So, something that we discussed during the Olympics.
In the shooter's context.
Shooter's context. Also, in general, those who make it to the Olympic Games at the last possible moment.
Right.
Our athletes, our swimmers.
Yeah.
So, Sajan Prakash, for instance, he made it he was the first Indian swimmer to qualify with the A mark. And he, post the Olympics, after he returned, he in interviews, he spoke about how he can't possibly within a month
have so many races.
In the sense, he qualified a month before.
Mm.
That was his peak.
Mm.
And he said to re-peak again for the Olympics and probably break the record, make the finals or whatever, he needed at least 6 weeks of training. The period is that. And he didn't have that. So this is something that we have discussed even before Sajan came out and said about this, that Indians peak for qualifying. So then forget the medal part of it, at least at least for the largest chunk. Of course, we won six medals and
seven
medals, and it's great to, of course, hockey, how can I forget that? And but the larger, the other question is why we compete at the Olympics, what is at stake, how, where, I mean, all these things are pretty ad hoc still, so that's something that in the coming years sports, since other things have been set, the money is coming in, talks is there, PR is there, and role models are there also in various sport, in athletics, for, I mean, imagine that, gold medalist in athletics. So now it's time to get the country to take off from where I mean, use this as a launch pad, and that requires planning, and for the elite athletes, different type of planning, for the grassroots, different types of planning, and let's see what the coming years turn that out. Right. Next year, like we always say, it's an important year. Asian Games and Commonwealth Games, we have many medalists in the Asian Games who never made it to the
Olympics.
So in that sense, the performance at these continental events, and in a larger sense, how much should we take it with a pinch of salt? That is also something that we need to.
Yeah.
And more than we as journalists, skeptical or not, it's also sports administrators. You should take note of such
things. Which leads us nicely into our next topic of conversation on this show, which otherwise. We're doing a year-ender, so there's a good chance that we'll talk for 2-3 hours. So, you know, in the interest of keeping things kind of on track and on time, firstly, so if someone can tell me how much time we've already done on the show. But secondly, the Olympics, Lizzie. I think a good way to kind of break this show up is also to club all of those Olympic sports into one. And since you're the man that's been covering most of that, an unexpected and brilliant gold medal performance from Neeraj Chopra. But beyond that, what did you make of the games, firstly? We'll get back to Neeraj in a bit.
Yeah, I mean, it was a bit, so on a personal note, I would say ki I was skeptical about the games being staged at when pandemic is around and such a mega event with all those players and officials and delegates coming in, and Tokyo having a free period with cases, and I've written pieces on that at that point, and then somehow after the Olympics, the piece I wrote was that I'm missing it. I just don't know what to do now.
The thrill has gone away.
So. That's games for you, and it's always inspiring. Whatever be the outcome, whatever be the number of medals that our country won, whether the records were broken, whether controversies were there, whether doping was there, all these things hardly matter because the games represent something larger as for sports lovers. And it's not by chance or fluke that even non-sport lovers hook on to the Olympic Games when it happens. That is its power, and that is what I guess, I mean, beyond the money and other factors that these guys were had vested interest in to stage the games. Beyond that, I think that is the power, that is the larger goal that everyone stands for. We can obviously say a lot about how that has been used to do a lot of other things, vested interests, whatever, but games was there, and as far as India is concerned, we underachieved in a way because our shooters misfired, and that again goes back to the conversation that we had, planning part of it, planning as well as protecting the athletes. I feel that there was a lot of muck being thrown around, especially the the shooters, young shooters who were supposed to win medals, like Manu Bakker, for instance, and tussle with the coach, and then officials coming in saying statements, other people saying stuff, Manu's family saying stuff, and all these things. I mean, on the eve of the Olympic Games, and then right through at the venue, it's not done. And also Manu's first event, she performed, she had bad luck and she performed badly. And after that, what did you do with that athlete? You need to get her to refocus because you have two more events left in the Luna. And she's again right up there for winning a medal. And instead of that, controversy, sources, this, that, and they just ruined it. That is just one case of it. And so for me, medals apart, when I look at India's performance at the Olympic Games, this highlights what is the problem for India. This the lack of understanding of the people who run sport in the country as to what they're dealing with. It's not a political game they're dealing with. Most of them have a political background. That's probably why this is happening. So sports persons competing in the field, it's not a political game at all. It's not an election rally at all. You have larger things at stake. People are involved in it with mind, body and matter. Everything is in tandem, has to be in place, working together. And in all that mess, I mean, if athletes come out and win medals, of course it is a special achievement. And that's where, when I look at Bajrang Punia's bronze medal, for instance. So there is this talk within wrestling fraternity that Bajrang is arrogant, Vinesh Phogat is arrogant, because they demand that they want this, they want that, and demand at times going against the federation officials, going vocally to the media. So Bajrang has had his coach Shako Bentinitis for a long while, and federation official, a senior federation official before the Olympics told me that the federation is waiting for him to fail. Then the axe will come, coach, whatever, and then we control you, you shut up and do stuff. So when Bajrang had that injury 1.5 months before the Olympic Games, it was actually a torrid period for him, for everybody involved. And the way he fought and won that medal, and if that, if not for that medal, he would have been completely made a, sidelines, made a scapegoat. He may not be sidelined because he will come back again. So same with Vinesh Phogat. After that, they hounded her till she came out into in the media and presented her case and presented the side that she has been mentally tortured with this. And then the officials had to step back. And
this is on the simple subject of a physio.
Of a physio. And wrestling as a sport, and you need a
highly demanding sport.
Highly demanding sport. You have limited number of. I do understand that limited number of officials were allowed because of the pandemic situation there. So, physios, maybe India had 5, 6, whatever, they had to be distributed among this thing. But a woman, I mean, we had women wrestlers in the mix, and she was just asking the women wrestling team needs a physio. Sindhu had a personal trainer and physio at the cost of other coaches. But that star power, I agree. But again, the wrestler in question here is also trying to use whatever the clout that she has to get what the basic requirement to compete at a high level. So it's a given. And for me, arrogance matter for sportsperson because that translates onto the playing field. And you just can't rein it in and then expect them to be super aggressive and fighting for that medal when that fight is being squeezed out of them by the system. So that is a major problem in Indian sport when you look at it. That the way they completely
control and completely dominate athletes.
Exactly. So athletes need to have that mindset right through, and that's it. And of course, if they are outrightly very wrong and all that, there is
It's not. That's why the system is in place.
System is in place.
So moving back to Neeraj Chopra, then of course we've talked enough about his actual Olympic winning performance.
In fact, our roundup was completely Neeraj only, I guess. After the Olympics, and then we promised everybody we'll talk about everyone
other
else.
Stuff.
And we didn't.
But we didn't. So but what next for Neeraj? I think that's the important part because, like you're talking about, planning is important. And it's a big year, and he has the chance to genuinely make a mark as being one of the best in his discipline ever, perhaps.
There is this thing, it's like last episode, I believe, or last to last episode, when we said about boycott Olympics, how it's a baggage. So Neeraj has a small baggage. It's that he won that gold with Johannes Wetter misfiring.
Right.
So I would say the next goal for him, because he has achieved a lot in his career, of course, the World Championship gold medal, and also it would be to win that global, any global tournament for that matter, major global tournament, with beating better on the field on a given day on equal terms, which is a sizable ask. And so he should be planning for that, because otherwise the next Olympic Games, we would see Neeraj competing and competing for the medals, but he should be competing for the gold as defending champion. So I'm sure inside his mind, and he's a pretty sorted, focused character. So inside his mind, that's what he wants. And he is working towards it. Just that after the Olympic Games, I felt that we as Indians failed him. Because we were celebrating him so much that he just lost. I mean, imagine he was running from one felicitation to another during COVID times, and he got fever. He was that stretched. And then forget all that, and 1 month later everything is settling in, but he's not been left alone to train to compete at IAAF Grand Prix event or whatever, when the rest of the world had started competing. So, and competing, why? Because again, peak was Olympics, but these guys are competing because they are. That's how they taper taper in to the next year. And next cycle, it's for as far as India or Asian countries are concerned, Asian Games cycle is there, and that is an important tournament for. I mean, probably Neeraj can just walk in and win that tournament, but he has to walk in and throw and win that tournament too. He has to throw above 85 to win. So. That's, and we have a very strong Pakistani javelin thrower who is right breathing down his neck also. They are great friends, but and it's great to see that rivalry too. And if two Asian throwers are competing for the Olympic and for a medal at the Olympic Games, nothing like that. I was hoping that he would be Pakistan, he would be there at the fag end of the Olympic finals, but he faded out. But yeah. So Neeraj would be, he's very clear that he wants to win all the medals that he has won, in the sense he win the Commonwealth Games again, win the Asian Games again, and plan that year like that. And beyond that, but the biggest challenge happens in Paris, where he would have to face Vetter, and Vetter would be keen to show that who's the boss. So interesting time for him. And also interesting time for athletics, Indian javelin also, because the thought was that this would explode into something big for the sport, big specifically for javelin also. Centers are being planned and all that. Does it work like that? That's a question, because we have javelin throwers whom Neeraj is helping too. When you interview Neeraj, I had an old friend say that, I called him once long back, that after his junior world title, that I went to interview. He's also a good thrower. He made him sit. So he's like that kind of a person. So javelin throwers are there in the system already, but they are here. So Neeraj is still an aberration. So how do you overcome that aberration? That would be the biggest challenge for Indian sport.
So basically, because take it from that 80 mark to the 90
mark. It's 88. If you can touch, you are there in the world level. I mean, better. But consistently 87, 88 plus means that you can win a medal. So that's the target. But we are not getting there, our other elite javelin throwers. And that is something that it's not Neeraj's problem. It's the system's problem.
But it should be an exciting year, I think, for Indian athletics, given these events that you're talking about, particularly the Asian Games, where you get to see a lot of the women athletes also, the younger athletes, the next generation, who are not perhaps at Olympic level yet, but hoping to build up to that. And I think last time we had a really good outing
at the Asian Games,
athletics-wise. So looking forward to more of the same there. Finally, I think, because Leslie almost forgot about it, but we have to devote 5 minutes to talking about hockey, because for Mr. Raghunandan, it's been a big year, I think, and he has of course, been covering the Olympics and hockey in general. Leslie spoke with him earlier because he's moved back. He's left us and gone back home, unfortunately. But Leslie spoke to him on the phone earlier, and this is what these guys chatted about.
Hi, Vaibhav. Thanks for joining in. So, yeah, let's getting straight to the point only. Hockey, your game, and good year. I mean, Olympic medal, and also the woman just missing out on the medal. And so we can't, when we look at Indian hockey and this performance, we can't look at it in isolation that way also, no? Because already when they reached the medals reckoning, there were talks about resurgence of Indian hockey and saying that the future is bright now, that we have we are back to where we belong. So realistically speaking, and assessing what has happened on the field and also around Indian hockey in general, as far as building of the future teams and the current structure and setup is concerned, do you think we can assign a larger meaning to that as far as progress of hockey is concerned?
Well, as we are speaking right now, there's like several tournaments happening in India right now, hockey tournaments. And I would say that when it comes to the hockey ecosystem itself, I guess players, coaches, they get enough opportunity to play. They get a lot of opportunity to play through the year, despite the fact that there is, I mean, last year, of course, it was a raging pandemic, so they had to cancel all national tournaments. But unlike several other sports, which have still not held their nationals, and which have held their nationals and like made it seem like they've done the sports persons a favor by holding them, hockey is still holding. Like, they've held the women interdepartmental nationals, which is a new tournament they brought about just to give more girls the chance to play and force more departments to give jobs and create sports quota teams for women. They're holding the men's interdepartmentals right now, the men's senior nationals right now, the women's senior nationals have happened. There is a lot of hockey happening. And it's always like, to be fair, in the last few years, this has constantly been the case. But the question we have to ask is like, how many people are actually watching this? How many people are paying attention to this? And I mean, we constantly demand that these things be shown on TV, on YouTube, and they're obviously not going to, because it's really tough to show these things and how many people are interested in any case.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to also ask about the women's game and later I'll get into the men's game again once more. But what about the women then? Because great performance again, but again, a period of change now that the head coach was right through with them, molding this team, is off now, Xavier Marine, and a new person has come in. And again, it's a cusp team because you have to blend in youngsters and all that. So how do you think these things are happening? And especially considering the fact that the structure for women's game is much more bad than what it is for the men's game in the country, as far as grassroots and...
So actually, Janak Shopman is not going to be like new to the team, because she was already a part of the team that went to Tokyo. She was, in fact, she is the iconic image of these hockey. Right. She was there in that picture. Yeah, yeah. And all the players speak really warmly of her. They all speak about how she is really invested in speaking and trying to help them grow mentally stronger, and speaks to them and has like an emotional connect with a huge number of them. And Sjord had a completely different style. Dutch, and even Janek is Dutch, but yeah. I guess for whatever reasons, their coaching styles are completely different. And so it's not going to be like a completely new face. I guess this sort of succession plan is quite useful.
Mm-hmm.
It's very helpful for them to have had. And besides that, when it comes to youngsters, there were a few youngsters in the team, and they're going to be more slowly coming up. They unfortunately had to postpone, or I don't know. Yeah, I guess postpone the
cricket
for the Junior World Cup, which is going to be held in South Africa, which would have been actually a really good measure to see like where our women's team is. But again, the success of the women's team has as much to do with the grit and determination and skill of our players and the tactics that Sjord implied, as it has to do with the fact that there were, several teams that did not have that sort of preparatory time, just did not have that amount of game time, and that's why we did really well. Now, how it translates into the bigger picture is like something that we're gonna have to wait and see. But sure, there are a lot more tournaments happening. There is a little bit more effort from Hockey India side. It has always been; they've always tried to have a little bit of equality, but. I really can't say. Like, I was speaking to Pritam Sivach, and she's a grassroots coach. She runs an academy, and three players that she literally groomed from when they were kids were in the women's team. And she was still saying that she doesn't have like an astroturf. She doesn't have a residential facility. She's petitioned the state government and the central government for funds for many years. They promised her a lot of funds when they qualified for the semifinals and when they went into the bronze medal match. Just before that, there were a lot of promises made which haven't been fulfilled. And one really strong point that she made was that instead of like we should like groom these sort of grassroots centers. And this is more pertinent for perhaps for girls in our country than it is for boys, simply because we are still a really patriarchal, regressive society where we don't want women to play sport. And if we want them to play sport, we want them to play like, you know? So, which is, I mean, the only way to break this, according to Sivach, is like, she has a facility where she runs grassroots sport. Mm. Everyone trusts her in that facility. She is producing players. She obviously has the skill set that coaches and scouts require. But because it's not a high performance facility, and because we are setting up these high performance facilities in like 3-4 corners of this country, girls are like a little bit, they don't want to go so far, they have concerns. So it's, I mean, it's still at a developing stage. And when it comes to women's hockey, I think we only started paying attention. Let's be very honest, we only started paying attention on like August 8th, 7th or 6th this year.
Of course, that's the time where the entire country was interested in that. And like you mentioned, the promises happened before the bronze match. And when the medal didn't come, I guess it's forgotten. So the chase for medal is what, I mean, of course, in sport, when you look at it, when you look at chasing the prize, that's a big deal because that's motivation, that is focus, that is a path that we need to traverse. But at the same time, it is proving to be a curse for Indian sport that way. Getting back to the men's team, that because you interestingly said that the Junior World Cup would have been a right measure for the young girls. The same thing applies to the men, and they played at the World Cup here in Bhubaneswar, and they fared. I mean, it was an underwhelming performance that way when you consider that they went in as defending champions and favorites. So, what do you reckon is this a sign of something? Wrong in that sense, because you're looking at Olympic bronze medalist senior team, and then we were expecting the junior teams would step into some of the roles that these great players of ours, in the senior setup are doing, and then they underperform.
I mean, again, like, I think this is like a bit of a, you can have like, there's this one strong view that all of us can share, which is that junior systems are really important. And it's really important to groom players at a young age. But this is like, there's two views now we can go down, which is one is that our earlier junior team, which contributed a lot of players to this bronze medal winning team, they were like put through a rigorous, it was like a single-minded determination by the federation, by the coaches, by everyone involved in hockey in this country to ensure that that team wins the Junior World Cup. All right, they played in the Australian Hockey League. They went and played there. All right, that team went and played there. They did like so many tours before the World Cup. Right, like they had so much game time as just a unit. And in that team, by the way, there were like 4 players who had turned out for India.
Yeah.
Whereas in this junior team that played a month back, there was only 1 player. That was the captain, Vivek Sagar Prashad.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like a two-way street where there was a single-minded determination to produce this team that is going to go and win the World Cup and then go ahead and like do glorious things for this country. The captain of that World Cup winning team, by the way, has disappeared. Everyone should know that. Like uska ek bahut hi acha movie aaya tha. Bahut hi acha bhi nahi bol sakta hoon main movie ko, but there was a movie that came out. And after that, he's completely disappeared. And there were others who've done really well, and there were others who've cemented their place in the team for the future. But I would say that to ensure that this cycle continues, rather than chasing success, we should follow the models that, say, teams like Australia and Belgium. Yeah, I mean, I always put Australia way before Belgium, simply because Australia have been doing this for 25 years. Yeah. Right? Belgium have been doing this recently, but sure.
With great results.
So the idea is not to win these things at the junior level, but ensure that you create enough quality that can just quickly be pumped up the conveyor belt.
Yeah.
And that is really the objective of, I would say, that's the objective they're driving towards. Winning a Junior World Cup is, I mean, it's really not such a big deal. If you think about it in football, Nigeria won the Under-17 World Cup the most number of times.
Yeah. Who cares?
Have they come close to winning the Senior World Cup ever?
Yeah.
Never. You know, so it's really something worth considering.
On that note, because we are at this for time as well. So thanks for sharing your input, sir. It's as usual, very in depth and well studied. So yeah, thanks for your time.
Thanks for having me. Thank you, man.
All right. So that brings us to a close of this year-end special episode of Playthings of Alien Forces from Leslie, myself, and the entire NewsClick team. Thanks for watching. Have a great end to the year, and hopefully 2022 will be better for all of us. We'll be back early in the new year, just taking a break for a couple of weeks to sort out some back end and other issues. But we'll be back early next year for more Playthings. And for more on all of these stories, of course, we'll be doing stories throughout. Visit our website, newsclick.in, and follow us on all the social media platforms. Thank you for watching. Happy New Year. Goodbye.